Lecture 2, given in Stuttgart on October 4th, 1922. In speaking of a movement among the youth, a clear distinction can be made between the youth movement in the wider sense and those young people who are particularly concerned with schools, with the sphere of education in general. I do not wish to emphasize either one or the other, but our aim will be most readily attained if we consider the main difficulties pertaining to the inner life among the young at universities and colleges. In these observations, we shall sometimes have to start from details and then quickly rise to a wider overview. Allow me then to say a few words first about the inner experiences undergone by young people at universities. Basically, this situation has been preparing for many decades, but recently it has reached a climax, making it much more clearly perceptible. Young people at the universities seek something. This is not surprising. Their purpose in going to college is precisely to seek something. They are looking for real leaders in those who teach them, for people who are both teachers and leaders, or, as would be equally correct, teachers endowed with leadership. But they have not found them. This is the really terrible fact, conveyed in all kinds of different words. One teacher spoke conservatively, another radically, one saying something very wise, another something very stupid. What is being said amounts to this: we can no longer find any teachers. What then have they found when they attend universities? Well, they have met people in whom they do not find what they are looking for. They have met people who pride themselves on not being teachers any longer, but researchers. Universities have established themselves as institutes for research. They are no longer there for human beings, but only for science, which has led an existence that it defines as, in quotes, objective. It has drummed into people in every possible key that it is to be respected as objective science. Sometimes such things must be expressed in an image. We may say that objective science is now going about among human beings, but it is not a human being. It is something non-human that is going about among people and calling itself objective science. This may be experienced in detail over and over again. How often is it not said, this or that has already been discovered, it already belongs to science. And then other things are added to science, and these so-called treasures of science are an accumulation that this dreadful objective existence has gradually acquired among humankind. But human beings do not really fit in with this objective being strutting around in their midst, for true and genuine humanity has no kinship with this cold, objective, stored-up being. True, with time, libraries and research institutes have been established. However, especially young people do not look for libraries or research institutes. They look in libraries for, it is almost beyond one to say the words, for human beings, and they find librarians. They look in the scientific institutes for educators, filled with enthusiasm for wisdom, for real knowledge, and they find those who are usually to be found in laboratories, scientific institutes, clinics, and the like. Those of the older generations have accustomed themselves to being so comfortable that they really do not want to be there in person at all. Only their institutes and libraries must be there. But human beings cannot do this. When they try not to be there in this way, then they are there for sure. Then they work not through the reality that lives in them as human beings, but through the leaden heaviness within them. One could express this in other ways too. Human beings strive toward nature. Nature, to give a radical example, is also around very young children, but in their soul and spirit, little children derive nothing from nature. Little children have to get something from nature by coming in contact with human beings, with whom they can experience nature in common. In a certain respect, this holds true right up to young adulthood. We must come together with other human beings with whom we can experience nature in common. This has been impossible during the last decades because no language existed in which people, young and old, could come to an understanding with one another about nature. When the older generation speaks of nature, it is as though they were darkening her, as though the names they give to the plants no longer fit them. Nothing fits. On the one hand, there is the riddle of plant, and we hear the names from the old, but they do not make sense because the human being was expelled, because the objective being science was wandering about on the earth. This is a state of things that came about gradually, but it has reached a certain culmination during recent decades. In the 19th century, it showed itself through a particular phenomenon in a significant way. In recent centuries, anyone with a little imagination, who cast an eye over the higher forms of culture, became acquainted at every turn with this objective creature, science, which came upon the scene in many different guises, but always wanted to be the one and only genuine objective science. But after having made its acquaintance, after having this objective science continually introduced to one, one could have the insight that another being stole bashfully away to the side because it felt that it was no longer tolerated. And if one were spurred to speak with this being secretly in the background, it would have said, "I have a name, but it may not be spoken in the presence of objective science. I am called philosophy, Sophia, wisdom." Bearing this ignominious prefix love, philosophia, however, something is attached to me that by its very name is connected with human inwardness and with love. I can no longer show myself. I have to go about bashfully. Objective science prides itself on having nothing of the philo in its makeup. Consequently, it has also lost the real Sophia. Nevertheless, I still move among you, for I still bear something sublime of feeling and humanity within me. Such an image could often present itself to the soul. It has expressed an undefined feeling in countless young people during recent decades. People have been trying to find forms of expression. As there are forms of expression for the life of thought, so too for the life of feeling, for what they are seeking. Those who were perhaps the most zealous, who felt the greatest warmth of youth, were the most vague, because all they really knew was, we are seeking something. But when they came to express what it was that they were seeking, it was actually nothing. In reality, the nothing was, in the words of Faust, the all, but it presented itself as a nothingness. It was a question of crossing an abyss. Such was the feeling, and basically it still is the feeling today. It can only be understood as historical, but historical in a new rather than in the old sense. Now I want to speak of something quite different, but gradually things will link themselves together. human beings who lived at the beginning of our era were able to feel quite differently from human beings today, because much that was old still lived in their feeling and sensing. Human beings had an inheritance in their souls. This heritage was not there only at the beginning of our era. It went far back into the Middle Ages. But now, souls enter into the world without it. The fact that souls come into the world without this heritage is very noticeable in the 20th century. That is one aspect. The other aspect is this. Suppose you were to ask somebody who lived at the beginning of our era if they spoke much about, in quotes, education. The farther back we go, the less we find that education is spoken about. Education, of course, may be spoken about in different ways. For instance, through education, the young should gradually be brought up to be what they want to be when they are old. For, after all, we must grow old in earthly life, however young we may still be. In earlier times, human beings were young and grew old in a more natural way. Today, people cannot be old and young in a way that is true to nature. People do not know any longer what it means to be young and what it means to be old. Nothing is known about it. And that is why there is such endless talk about education. Because there is a longing to know how to teach young people to be young in order that they may grow old respectively. But nobody knows how to direct things so that human beings should be truly young, and how in youth they can decently assimilate what will enable them to become old in a worthy manner. Centuries ago, all this was a matter of course. A great deal is said today about education. Mostly, we do not realize the absurdity of what is said. Today, almost everyone is talking about education, and why? Mostly, people have only the vaguest realization of having been so badly educated, and yet they attribute their difficulties in life to it. People talk about it because they find that they are uneducated. They admit this, but they have never experienced anything appropriate in this domain. Nonetheless, they form conclusions. People cry for programs in education merely because they feel so insecure in themselves. One could also show that a strong will is present on all sides, but a will without any real content. That is exactly what the young are feeling, that there is no content in this will. Why is there no content? Because only recently something genuinely new has arisen in Earth evolution. I can indicate this only in broad outline, but if you look at my book, titled Outline of Esoteric Science, it will be brought home to you. There you will find that the Earth is shown as a heritage of other world existences. The names are immaterial. I have called them Saturn, Sun, and Moon existences. But the first Earth existence was only a repetition of earlier world existences. On the Earth, we may say that there have been three periods of repetition, a Saturn, a Sun, and a Moon period. Then came the Earth period proper. But this Earth period proper, the Atlantean epoch, was again only a repetition, at a higher level, of what was there earlier. Then came the post-Atlantean time, a still higher stage. But this again was a repetition. The post-Atlantean epoch was a repetition of a repetition. Until the 15th century, humankind actually lived on nothing but repetitions, on nothing but a heritage. Up into the 15th century, the human soul was by no means an unwritten page. Before then, many things rose up of themselves in the soul. But from the 15th century onward, souls were really unwritten pages, and the earth was new. Before that, the human beings lived on the earth only with what they inherited. As a rule, no one pays any attention to the fact that only since the 15th century the earth is new. Before then, human beings were fed on the past. Since the 15th century, they have been standing face to face with nothingness. The soul is an unwritten page. And how have human beings been living since the 15th century? At first, children inherited from their parents, through tradition, what had once been inherited in a different way, so that from the 15th into the 19th century, tradition was still there. But as you can see, tradition has fared gradually worse and worse. Think, for example, of the sphere of rights. It would never have occurred to someone like Scotus Origina to speak of rights as modern people speak, because at that time there was still something in their souls that led human beings to speak person to person. This is no longer so, because there is nothing in the soul that leads to the human being. People have found nothing yet that leads out of the nothingness. At one time, parents could at least speak to their children. But at the end of the 18th century, things had gone so far that a parent had really nothing to say to a child anymore. Then people began to seek in a cramped manner, to begin with, the so-called, quote, rights of reason, close quote. Ideas and feelings on the subject of rights were supposed to be pressed out of reason. Then Sauvigny and others discovered that nothing more could be pressed out of reason. People began to establish rights according to history, where it was a question of studying earlier conditions and cramming themselves with the feelings of people long since dead, because there was nothing left within them. Rights of reason were a cramped clinging to what had already been lost. Rights, according to history, were a confession that nothing more was to be gotten out of the human beings of the day. Such was the situation at the onset of the 20th century. The feeling grew keener and keener that humankind was facing a nothingness, and that something must come from within the human being. In ancient Greece, nobody would have known how to speak about objective science. Human beings expressed their relationship to the world in a different way. By referring to spiritual vision, they spoke of melpomene, or urania, and so on, of the liberal arts. Although these liberal arts were real, they did not go about on the earth. Even in the age of philosophy, the Greeks experienced their connection with the spiritual world to be concrete. The muses were genuinely loved, and they were real beings with whom human beings had a relationship. Homer's words, quote, "Sing, O muse, of the wrath of Peleus's son, Achilles," close quote, were not the mere phraseology they are thought to be by modern scholars. Homer felt himself to be a kind of chalice, and the muse spoke out of him as a higher humanity that filled him. As Klopstock did not want to speak any more out of the empty phrase, which was already prevalent in the world into which he was born, at least he still said, "Sing, immortal soul, of that sinner's redemption." But this immortal soul, too, has disappeared, little by little. It was a slow and gradual process. In the first centuries of Christendom, we find that the once concrete muses had become dreadfully withered ladies. Grammar, dialectic, rhetoric, arithmetic, geometry, astrology, music. They had lost all concrete reality. Already with Boethius, they had almost no more concrete physiognomy. It is actually impossible to love them any longer. But even so, they are still sturdy figures in comparison with the objective science that goes about as a being among us today. Little by little, human beings have lost the connection they had in olden times with the spiritual world. They had to lose this connection because they had to develop to full freedom in order to shape all that is human out of themselves. To this, human beings have been called since the 15th century. But it was not really felt until the end of the 19th, and especially in the 20th century. For now, not only was the inheritance lost, but the traditions were lost too. Parents had nothing to tell their children. The feeling was, we are facing a nothingness. People began to sense that the earth has, in fact, become new. What I have said here can be put another way, by considering what would have become of the earth without the Christ event. Suppose there had been no Christ event. The earth, as it lives in the human life of soul and spirit, would gradually have withered. The Christ event could not wait until the modern age. It had to occur somewhat earlier, before the time when the old inheritance had gone, in order that the Christ event could at least be felt through the old inherited qualities of soul. Just imagine what it would have been like if the Christ event, at the beginning of our era, had come about at the end of the 19th or in the 20th century. How our contemporaries would laugh to scorn the pretension that any event like the Christ event should be of such significance. One cannot imagine what human beings would have felt about such pretension. At the time of the Christ event, quite a different kind of feeling had to be there. The feeling of standing before a nothingness could not yet be allowed at that time. The Christ event came during the first third of the fourth post-Atlantean epoch, and with that same fourth epoch, which bears the Christ event in the first third, the old was finished. Something new begins in the 15th century, with the fifth post-Atlantean epoch in which we are now living. In this epoch there are no traditions. They have gradually faded out. In this epoch, as regards the Christ event, as regards the deeper, more intimate religious questions, people clearly stand before a nothingness. It has even become impossible for theologians to understand the Christ event. Try to get from contemporary theology an intelligible conception of the Christ event. Those who argue the Christ away from out of Jesus pass as the greatest theologians today. Quite obviously, human beings are facing the nothingness, the void. I am only describing symptoms, for these things take place in the deeper layers of human soul life. These layers of soul conjure into the souls of that humanity which has become young in recent decades, something that makes them feel cut off from the stream of world happenings. Something has entered the evolution of the human soul, which is to be likened to a terrible jerk. Suppose my hand were capable of feeling of its own accord and were chopped off. What would it feel? It would feel cut off, dried up. It would no longer feel itself to be living. This is what the human soul has been feeling since the last third of the 19th century, in regard to the general stream of world happenings. The soul feels cut off, chopped off, and the anxious question is, how can I once again become alive in my soul? But then, when one strives to speak out of the impulses that can bring life again, those who want to muddle along on the lines of the old spiritual life simply do not understand at all. How little is understood of what is spoken out of life about the founding of the Waldorf school. For the most part, people hear something quite different about the Waldorf school from what they ought to hear. They hear only that one speaks to them the way one spoke already decades ago. They can find the mere words that are spoken today about the Waldorf school in books. They find every single word in earlier books. But when one wants to use different words, or perhaps only different ways of putting the sentences together, then people say that it is bad style. They have not the remotest notion of what must be done now, when human beings who still have a soul in their bodies must inevitably face the nothingness. Waldorf school education must be listened to with other ears than those with which one hears about other kinds of education or educational reform. For the Waldorf school gives no answer to the questions people want to have answered today, and which are ostensibly answered by other systems of education. What is the aim of such questions? Their usual aim is much reason or intelligence, of which the present time has an incalculable amount. Intelligence, intellect, cleverness, these are widespread commodities at the present time. One can give terribly intelligent answers to questions like, what should we make out of the children? How should we inculcate this or that into this child? The ultimate result is that people answer the question for themselves, what pleases me in the child, and how can I get the child to become what I want him or her to be? But such questions have no significance in the deeper evolutionary course of humanity. And to such questions, Waldorf pedagogy gives no reply at all. To give a picture of what Waldorf education is, we must say that it speaks quite differently from the way in which people speak elsewhere in the sphere of education. Waldorf education is not a pedagogical system, but an art to awaken what is actually there within the human being. Fundamentally, the Waldorf school pedagogy does not want to educate, but to awaken. For today, it is a matter of awakening. First of all, the teachers must be awakened, and then the teachers must awaken the children and the young people. An awakening is needed, now that humankind has been cut off from the stream of world evolution in general. Just as a hand goes to sleep when it is blocked from the circulation of the body, so too humanity fell asleep in soul and spirit. You object, saying that human beings have made great progress since the 15th century. They have developed such colossal cleverness. If World War I had not come, which, by the way, was not the experience that it might have been, although people did realize to a slight extent that they were not so very clever after all, heaven knows how often we would hear the phrase, "We've made such splendid progress." It would have become unbearable. Certainly in the sphere of the intellect, tremendous progress has been made since the 15th century. But this intellect has something dreadfully deceptive about it. For people think that in their intellects they are awake. But the intellect teaches us nothing about the world. It is, in reality, nothing but a dream of the world. In the intellect, more emphatically than anywhere else, a human being dreams. And because objective science works mostly with the intellect, which it applies to observation and experiment, science basically dreams about the world. It all remains a dreaming. Through the intellect, a human being no longer has an objective relation with the world. The intellect is the automatic continuation of thinking after one has been long cut off from the world. That is why human beings of the present day, when they feel their soul within them, when they get a feeling of themselves in their soul, are again seeking a real link with the world, a return to the world. Here, one makes a peculiar discovery. If up till the 15th century, human beings had positive inheritances. Now they are confronting a reversed inheritance, a negative inheritance. Up into the 15th century, humanity could welcome with joy what it inherited from the evolution of the world. The world had not been completely unrolled, and human beings were not altogether cut off from it. One could greet what one received with joy. Also, today, after the cutting off has occurred, one can ponder what one receives from the world without one's own effort. However, then a strange discovery is made, like someone who is left a legacy and forgets to inform himself or herself about it accurately. Then a calculation is made, and it is discovered that the debits exceed the assets. The opportunity of refusing the legacy has been missed, but this means a definite amount of debts which have to be paid. It is a negative inheritance. There are such cases. So also humanity has a negative inheritance in its soul, even concerning the greatest event that has ever happened in humanity's evolution. Up to the time of Golgotha, it was not necessary for human beings to understand the mystery of Golgotha, because it had not taken place. Then it happened. And with the remains of ancient inheritance, it could still be dimly understood in the age that followed. Then came the 15th century, when such remains of inheritance were no longer there, when, however, it was still possible for parent to pass on to child an understanding for the mystery of Golgotha. None of this helps any longer today. People are dreadfully clever. Yet even in the 7th and 8th centuries, they would have been clever enough to perceive the contradictions in the four Gospels. The contradictions are, after all, very easy to discover. However, people began to investigate them for the first time in the 19th century, and so it is in every domain of life. The intellect was overvalued, and a consciousness or feeling for the event of Golgotha was lost. Religious feeling was lost in consciousness. But in its innermost depths, the soul has not lost this feeling, and the young are asking, what was the mystery of Golgotha in reality? The elders were unable to say anything about it. I am not implying that the young are capable of this either, or that anything is known about it at the universities. What I am saying is that something ought to be known about it. To sum up, a striving to understand the mystery of Golgotha once again is taking place, although chaotically, in the depths of human souls. A new experience of Christ is being sought. We are standing necessarily before a new experience of the Christ event. In its first form, it was experienced with the remains of the old soul inheritances, and because since the 15th century they were exhausted, the experience was carried on through tradition. Only in the last third of the 19th century was the darkness complete. There was no longer any inheritance. A light must be sought once again from out of the darkness within the human soul. The spiritual world must be experienced in a new way. This is the significant experience that is living in the souls of profounder natures of the modern youth movement. By no means superficially, but in a deeper sense, it is clear that for the first time in the historical evolution of humankind, there must be an experience that comes wholly from out of the human being. As long as this is not realized, it is impossible to speak of education. The fundamental question is, how does one achieve the most primal spiritual experiencing in the soul? Original spiritual experience in the human soul is something that stands before the awakening of human beings in the new century, as the all-embracing, unexpressed riddle of the human being and of the world. The question is how human beings are to awaken the deepest nature within themselves, how they can awaken themselves. Even the most zealous spirits among awakening humanity, I can only express it in a picture, are like the one who only half wakes in the morning with heavy limbs and is unable to come fully out of sleep. That is how human beings feel today, as if unable to completely emerge from the state of sleep. This fact lies at the root of a striving that has been expressed in many different forms during recent decades, and is still shining today into the souls of the young in a sympathetic manner. It expresses itself in the striving for community among young people. One seeks something. I said yesterday that the human being has lost the human being. The human being is seeking the human being again. Up into the 15th century, human beings had not lost one another. Naturally, evolution cannot be turned back to an earlier condition, and it would be dreadful if we wanted to attempt it. We do not wish to become reactionaries. Nevertheless, it is a fact that up into the 15th century, human beings could still find the human being. Since that century, through tradition and through what the parent was still able to say, one could receive dim thought pictures that made one aware the other person there is a human being. People sensed dimly that this form going about beside them was also a human being. In the 20th century, this has vanished. There is no more tradition that tells one anything, and yet one still seeks for the human being. Human beings are really seeking the human being. And why? Because in reality they are seeking something quite different. If things continue as they were at the turn of the century, then no one will wake up. For the others too are in the state where they are incapable of awakening anybody. In the end, human beings must be something for each other. Human beings must mean something to one another also in the community. It is this that has radiated through Waldorf school education from the beginning. It does not aim to be a system of principles, but an impulse to awaken. It aims at being life, not knowing, not cleverness, but art, vital action, awakening deed. That is, what matters is a question of awakening, for evolution has made human beings fall into a sleep that is filled with intellectualistic dreams. Even in the ordinary dream, people often become megalomaniacs. Yet ordinary dreaming is a mere nothing compared with intellectualistic dreaming. When an awakening is at stake, it will simply not do to go any further with intellectualism. This objective science, which goes about and has discarded all its old clothes because it fears that something genuinely human might be found in them, has surrounded itself with a thick fog, with the mantle of objectivity. And so nobody notices what is going about in this objectivity of science. People need something human again. Human beings must be awakened. Yes, my dear friends, if an awakening is to take place, the mystery of Golgotha must be experienced again. In the mystery of Golgotha, besides the earthly Jesus, yet another spiritual being came onto the earth. In earlier times, this was grasped with ancient powers of the soul. The 20th century challenges us to understand it with new powers. Modern youth, when it understands itself rightly, demands to be awakened in its consciousness, not in the old slumbering powers of the soul as before. And this can only happen through the Spirit. It can only happen if the Spirit actually sends its sparks into the communities people are seeking for today. The Spirit must be the awakener. We can make progress only when we realize the tragic state of world happenings in our day. Namely, that we are facing the nothingness that we necessarily have to face in earthly evolution in order to establish human freedom. And in the face of the nothingness, we need an awakening in the spirit. Only the spirit can open the shutters, for otherwise they will remain tightly shut. Objective science, I cast no reproaches and do not mistake its great merits, will, in spite of everything, leave these shutters tightly closed. For science is only willing to concern itself with the earthly. But since the 15th century, the forces that can awaken human beings no longer live in the earthly. The awakening must be sought in what is super-earthly within the human being. This is actually the deepest quest, in whatever forms it may appear. Those who speak of something new and are inwardly earnest and sincere should ask themselves, how can we find the unearthly, the supersensible, the spiritual within our own being? This need not again be clothed in intellectualistic forms. Truly it can be sought in concrete forms. Indeed it must be sought in such forms. Most certainly it cannot be sought in intellectualistic forms. If you ask me why you have come here today, it is because there is living within you this question, how can we find the Spirit? If you see in the right light what has impelled you to come, you will find that it is simply this question, how can we find the Spirit, which, out of the forces of the present time, is working in us? How can we find this Spirit? In the next few days, my dear friends, we will try to find this Spirit. The end of Lecture 2.